Good morning. Good morning. My name is Farah Pandith, and I'm the special representative to Muslim communities here at the Department of State. It's a pleasure to welcome you. We are all here to join Secretary Clinton as she launches the Women in Public Service Project. Secretary Clinton. Secretary Clinton announced this initiative exactly 9 months ago in New York City at an event commemorating the 100th anniversary of International Women's Day. She stated that the State Department, in partnership with the Seven Sister Colleges, Barnard, Smith, Bryn Mawr, Mount Holyoke, and Wellesley, would lead the charge to bring a new generation of women from every corner of the world into careers in public service. As a proud graduate of a women's college myself, I know firsthand the special ethos of these schools and the impact of the legacy of generations of female pioneers who have changed perspectives and forged new ideas. This initiative is the first of its kind, initiated by a government to put front and center the facts about women in the public sector, and to create a roadmap and tools to catalyze change. The global challenges we face cannot be solved without women. More must be done. Many of you are students or graduates of women's colleges. Others are focused on gender issues professionally. Several of you come from the private sector, where we have seen the impact women have had in boardrooms and economies. But most importantly, we have assembled here mentors, teachers, confidants, and heroes to the women around them. Here at the Department of State, we take women in public service very seriously. This is certainly no surprise with Secretary Clinton at the helm. 4 out of 6 of our undersecretaries of state are women, including Wendy Sherman, who is the first female undersecretary for political affairs. Over 40 of our American ambassadors are female, representing our nation at the highest level. But something is also happening outside of Foggy Bottom. The Washington Post called it the Hillary effect. Currently, there are more female foreign ambassadors posted in Washington than ever before. Who says one person can't make a difference? Look around you. You are sitting shoulder to shoulder with representatives from every continent and age group. We have heads of state, cabinet ministers, parliamentarians, ambassadors, local government officials, commissioners, and student leaders interested in entering into careers in public service. You are each a part of building a new generation of women who will impact their communities and their countries. Whether a woman is serving in a local office, like Anna Mie Ellerslev, the 27-year-old deputy mayor of Copenhagen, who is working to make her city the most inclusive city in Europe, or shaping policy at the national level, like Asma Bashir, who is a rising star at the Ministry of Ethnic Affairs in New Zealand, we all know that having women at the policy table is essential to building stronger, more prosperous cities, states, and nations. Again, welcome and enjoy your day.
I'm Carol Chris, president of Smith College, and it's my honor to welcome you on behalf of the Women in Public Service Project's founding educational partners, Barnard, Bryn Mawr, Mount Holyoke, Smith, and Wellesley Colleges. Throughout our history, we've had the opportunity to educate women of promise from all over the world who today lead and serve in every cultural and civic capacity. Their ties to one another through the experience of women's education constitute a network spanning continents and generations. I thank Secretary Clinton, one of the most visible and respected figures in public life today, for her leadership in bringing more women into careers in public service and for welcoming our students, faculty, and alumni to the State Department for this historic event. My thanks as well to Milan Verveer, Ambassador at Large for Global Women's Issues, and Farah Panda, Special Representative to Muslim Communities, for their leadership in bringing this initiative to fruition. Today, we launch a transformative vision for social change. Our goal is this: to challenge the world community to identify, educate, and advance a new generation of women committed to public service. It's no secret, around the world and in the US, in villages, cities, parliaments, and legislatures, women emerging into public service hold the key to improving governance, expanding civil rights, combating corruption, and advancing civil society. The work we do here today and in the coming months and years will ensure that their talents and passion to serve the public good are met with the educational resources and global networks to power their success. Bringing gender equity to public service is an ambitious project requiring the efforts of committed people and organizations around the world. The founding partners look forward to working with those of you gathered here today who represent NGOs, foundations, the private sector, and other academic institutions in realizing our vision. On behalf of my seven sister colleagues, on behalf of the women that we educate, and the families, communities, and nations that they represent, I thank you for joining us in this project.
Good morning. I'm Elan Verveer, the first U.S. Ambassador for Global Women's Issues. Let me add my welcome to each and every one of you, because it is truly so inspiring to have so many women and men here this morning with us who are committed to promoting the full and equal participation of women in public service around the world. But it is my special task this morning to introduce a woman whose life has personified public service. As a student government president at Wellesley, she led her schoolmates during the turbulent 60s. As law student, she embarked on a personal commitment to protect the rights of children. As First Lady of Arkansas, she led a major campaign to improve public education and promoted a program to support poor mothers as the first teachers of their children. As First Lady of this country, she worked hard to promote issues vital to families, from health care to child care, from civic engagement to the economy. And on the global stage, in every corner of the world, from Tanzania to Thailand, she championed women's rights as human rights and sparked a movement to raise the status of women and girls around the world. And she dared to compete in the political arena by running for the Senate from New York, becoming the first woman to independently win statewide office. And as senator, she devoted herself to improving the lives of her constituents and all Americans. And yes, she took on perhaps the toughest public service challenge of all by running for President of the United States. In the end, she put 15 million cracks in that glass ceiling, leading the way for that first woman who will one day become president. And then, at President Obama's request, she agreed to serve her country as Secretary of State and is traveling tirelessly around the globe to advance America's national interests, to bridge divides, to promote peace, and the human rights of women and men everywhere. She is a woman who truly believes that we are all called to make a difference, that each of us must be the change we want to see in the world. Please welcome Secretary of State Hillary Clinton.
Thank you, my friend.
Thank you all. Thank you. Well, actually, it was 18 million cracks, but who's counting? I am so pleased to see all of you here this morning. We are looking forward to the activities of the day and even more to all of the work that follows. And I want to thank each and every one of you, whether you are policymakers, public officials, admirals or generals, students, academics, aspiring public servants, for coming together to help tackle what I believe is a critical issue, finding ways to ensure that more women are inspired and empowered with the tools they need to participate fully in the governance of their nations. Now, we have assembled a constellation of some of the world's leading public servants today to share their experiences and wisdom on this topic. And it is my honor and privilege to introduce one of the brightest stars in that constellation, Christine Lagarde. And I was... I was delighted when she was named as France's finance minister, the first woman ever to hold that position. I appreciated greatly the important work she did through the G20 to help address financial regulation and strengthen economic governance. And in our dealings together, I always admired her eloquence, directness, and clear-eyed vision. So I was personally delighted when she was appointed managing director of the International Monetary Fund, and at a time when leadership was so necessary as our nations continue to address the challenges of our global economy. I am very reassured that Christine Lagarde is on the job. It is a job that waits for no one, so I asked her to speak first because she has to leave immediately to continue to attend to her important responsibilities. So please join me in welcoming Christine Lagarde, Managing Director of the International Monetary Fund.
Bonjour and good morning. Thank you so much, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, for your introduction, and thank you very much for having me with you and with this extraordinary group of women, young, older, senior, engaged in public service. I think it's a wonderful initiative that you have taken back in March, and only a lady like you could do that. I'd like to add to the very, very true introduction that was given by Madam Ambassador. I would like to add one component which I know about you and which I particularly admire in addition to the rest of it. And it's something that I believe we should all reflect on. Typically, it's more comfortable to stay in our area, not to take too many challenges, to do our job well, to be conscientious, as very often women are, and more so than others. But it's quite rare to see somebody at that level of standing, recognition, acknowledgement around the world who's prepared to take the ultimate risk, which is to actually run for an office where she's not certain that she's going to get in. And the ability to take that risk, to run the risk of failing, is something that I admire greatly and that should inspire us a lot. Now, I was very much hoping this morning when joining your group that I would have an easy time, that I would not have to talk about Europe. And let it be known, first thing that I was asked when we had this little gathering before we walked into the room was, I hope you're going to tell us all about Europe. So I thought I would say a few words about the world economic outlook as we see it from the IMF, as I see it with my background as former Minister of Finance and currently Managing Director of the IMF. And then I would like to just say a few words about leadership and diversity and how it can actually make a difference in relation to the world economic situation as it is on a global basis. Now, the world economic outlook at the moment is not particularly rosy. It is quite gloomy, and pretty much wherever your eyes will go, it's down, downside risk, revision downward, slower growth than expected, higher deficit than predicted, and public finances that are not in particular good condition. And that is pretty much true the world over. Luckily, at the moment, the emerging market economies in particular, and some of those countries that were badly affected in the 80s and in the 90s, and I'm talking here about Asia, about Latin America, are faring a lot better than the advanced economies. And that is no surprise. They, at the time, in the 80s and in the 90s, took the effort, took the time, took the energy, often with the support of the IMF, however resented it was later on, to actually sort out some of the issues that are currently faced by the advanced economies in terms of solidity of their banking system, in terms of the reliability of their supervision when it comes to the financial institutions and financial market, in terms of focusing on the competitiveness of their economies. And all those challenges that they faced in the days of the Asian crisis, of the Latin American crisis, have now served them well because they were more solid in the financial crisis that has hit pretty much the entire world back in late 2008 and 2009. Now, the issues that we have in front of us now are not just a concern for the Eurozone, not just a concern for the European Union, not just a concern for the advanced economies. It's a concern for all economies, because if there is one finding that is unchallenged, it's the vast interconnectedness between all economies. And there is no economy in the world, whether low-income countries, emerging markets, middle-income countries, or super-advanced economies, that will be immune to the crisis that we see not only unfolding, but escalating at a point where everybody would actually have to be focused on what it can do. And let me just make one point here, which is really very important to me. It's not a crisis that will be resolved by one group of countries taking action. It's going to be hopefully resolved by all countries, all regions, all categories of countries actually taking action. And what will be required is very much what has been advocated by Secretary of State Hillary Clinton. It's the encompassing holistic approach to problems, not just focusing on what happens in one particular segment of the world, one particular segment of the economy, but on an overall basis. And it's going to require efforts, it's going to require adjustment, and clearly it's going to have to start from the core of the crisis at the moment, which is obviously the European countries, and in particular, the countries of the Eurozone, which are sharing this monetary union that has not been properly completed by an economic and a fiscal union, which is currently in the works. Now, pay attention to one word that I just mentioned, currently. It would be ideal and it would be lovely from a market perspective if it was not just currently, but immediately signed, sealed, delivered, done deal overnight. Unfortunately, for those of you who have the privilege of belonging to democracies, things do not happen in that way, and things do take time and have to go through parliamentary processes, through the democratic rules that we cherish. But those rules, those timing, do not coincide with market expectations and market timings. And it's really that Gordian knot that needs to be cracked, that needs to be addressed as collectively as possible, starting with those at the center, but with the support of the international community, probably channeled through the IMF, that will actually address this issue of moving the institutional framework of that zone of the world, as well as organizing a collective financial responsibility, a fiscal solidarity, and that element of risk sharing that is expected pretty much around the globe. So it's a monumental task that the European leaders have begun to address and that will have to be continued to address relentlessly with decisiveness and certainly collectively under support of the international community. Because if that doesn't happen, the risk from an economic point of view is that of retraction, rising protectionism, isolation, and this is exactly the description of what happened in the 30s, and what followed was not something that we are looking forward to. And it's not the place for a call to action, but it is certainly a place for collective reflection, because I believe that both leadership and diversity are in cruel demand in that particular situation. Leadership and diversity, because it's a question of courage. It's a question of actually facing the issues, not being in denial, accepting the truth, accepting the reality, and then dealing with it. And frankly, from my previous life, either in the private sector or as Minister of Finance, or in my current position, it's a set of skills that women excel at. There have been various research. I think McKinsey is the last one to have done thorough research on the matter back in 2009, to conclude that the skills and the attributes and the principles and the methods generally used by women, and it's not, you know, attributable to a gender rather than the other, but it's just an empirical conclusion and findings, that those skills, principles, and values that we typically rely upon are best used in times of crisis and post-crisis situation. So I would certainly hope that we, representing very often a minority, particularly in economic circles, particularly in the financial world, we can actually engage without discriminating, without being aggressive, without being unnecessarily pushy. I said unnecessarily, Madeleine. Occasionally, yes. We actually make space for ourselves and our sisters so that there is real mixity, real gender equilibrium in those forums where decisions are made. I will conclude, because I don't want to bore you for too long, but I will conclude with two tips. The first one is one that I've used when I was Minister of Finance. As Minister of Finance for France, I had responsibility for the portfolio of holdings that we had in multiple companies. France still has ownership of quite a bit of the private sector, less so than many years ago, but still we do. And in those days, there was a big push to have more women on the boards of companies. And that has partly succeeded thanks to efforts by our parliaments. But in the companies that were owned by the state, there was a huge resistance to having women on the boards. And how often did I hear the presidents of those companies say, you know, I would love to have women on the board. I would really love it. It would be great. You're a terrific role model, and we could, you know, sort of take inspiration from you. But you know what? I can't find any. I can't find any. So having heard that, you know, several times in a row, I thought, okay, I'm going to do something. And I prepared for myself, with a little bit of complicity by some of my women friends, a list of capable women board members, either capable because they demonstrated their capabilities by having been or being on boards, or simply because they had all the attributes, all the understanding and the knowledge for being good board members, responsible, accountable, and you know, sometimes literate. So next time one of those presidents said, it'd be great. It's really, really, really. I would do it any time. But I can't find any. I said, oh, you know what? I have a list. You can pick. And you can do exactly the same thing wherever you are, because you are in positions of responsibilities, and I'm sure that it sounds familiar to you what I just said. And if you are not yet in position of high responsibilities, the place where you can actually choose and influence and decide. You will be, because you have the talent and you have the capabilities to do so. So keep that in mind and start building your list for those of you who are from Smith or from various other colleges in the room. Do it. Do it. And keep it with you. You will be able to use it. My second tip is, whatever you do, especially if you are in a minority, take the slack. Bear the bashing. Grit your teeth and smile, because there will be others after you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Christine, and those words of advice, I think, will be taken to heart by everyone here. I also want to add my words of welcome and thanks to the presidents of the Seven Sisters Colleges. You'll be hearing from all of them throughout the day, but certainly from Barnard and Bryn Mawr, Mount Holyoke, Smith, and Wellesley. I thank you all for your vision and leadership, as well as hard work in developing this Women in Public Service project. And I have to add a special personal hello to all my Wellesley sisters. I want a special moment of appreciation for the President of Kosovo, who will also be participating in the program later. President Yayaga has shown incredible courage and leadership in her time as president of her country, and she recently gave the first ever speech to her assembly, and in it she called for the creation of a presidential commission to fight corruption, and I applaud her for that. To all the members of the diplomatic corps, members of Congress, cabinet officials, past and present, including Secretaries Albright, Sebelius, and Solis, as well as a number of accomplished women from our armed forces, who we are very proud to have join us here today. There is no greater public service than military service, and you exemplify that to everyone. And I add my thanks to Farah, who's done a terrific job in everything she's undertaken here, and my longtime friend and indefatigable advocate for women, Milan Verveer. And then let me welcome all those who are watching live through watch parties via the web, including from our embassies in Brazil, Canada, and Kosovo. And to all who are here as part of this opening convocation about what we hope will be a continuing commitment that brings many more women into public service around the world. You know, I have been privileged to travel extensively. I've seen the many different ways women contribute. I've met activists working to advance human rights from Belarus to Uzbekistan. I've met with young women standing up for representative government in Tunisia, Libya, and Egypt. I've watched entrepreneurs in Africa, Asia, and Latin America working to improve their lives, the lives of their children, their employees, and local economies. And today, we are addressing another way that women can make a great contribution through public service. I have been fortunate to serve in different capacities in my life and have had the support of so many people. But even with all that support, I remember listening to Christine, the trepidation that I felt when I was being pushed to consider running for a Senate seat in New York. I had never run for elected office. I wasn't sure it was the right thing to do. And one day I would wake up and say, absolutely not going to do it. Next day I'd wake up and say, well, you know, so-and-so called me. Maybe I should reconsider. And I was on this roller coaster of emotions. until I got what I chose to take as a sign. I was at an event promoting a documentary about women in sports in a gymnasium in a high school in New York City. And we were gathered under a giant banner that happened to be the name of the documentary, which was Dare to Compete. And you know where this is going, right? So just as I stepped forward, having been introduced by this very incredibly dynamic young and tall woman who happened to be the captain of the high school basketball team, I went up to shake her hand to thank her, and she leaned over to me and whispered in my ear, "Dare to compete, Mrs. Clinton, dare to compete." So soon after that, I decided to enter the race, and it was one of the best decisions of my life. And I tell you that because I appreciate, you know, how daunting it is to consider a career in public service in any country in the world. And Christine's last comments about, you know, grinning and bearing it, reflects the reality. So it's not as though there's been this huge cosmic change. It still is hard. And that's more than reflected in the numbers that we see. Women account for more than 50% of the global population, but hold less than 20% of all parliamentary seats across the globe. And of course, I'm embarrassed to say, in the United States, that percentage is even lower. Women make up only 17% of our own Congress and only a quarter of the seats in all of our state legislatures. Now, of course, public service is not only about running for elected office. There are many ways that women can serve, and we recently saw three courageous women being awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for the work that they have done in Liberia and Yemen. So you don't have to be a president or a prime minister or a party leader to serve. We need women at all levels of government, from executive mansions and foreign ministries to municipal halls and planning commissions, from negotiating international disarmament treaties to debating town ordinances. And as I will discuss tomorrow at the International Crisis Group, women must also be fully integrated into efforts to negotiate and sustain peace after war and conflict. And that is especially important because in today's conflicts, women and children are the primary victims, whether they bear the brunt of the actual attacks or whether they're the ancillary victims, often because of rape being used as a tool of war, or whether they are forced to leave their homes to find their way to refugee camps. So women have a very personal stake in resolving conflicts. And a wonderful movie about the end of the Liberian wars called Pray the Devil Back to Hell, which talked about how women in Liberia finally were tired of seeing no progress in ending the relentless, horrific attacks that were being carried out, basically went to where an all-male peace conference was being held in Ghana and sat in and would not leave until agreements were reached. Now, there are many benefits of bringing more women into government service, whether they are elected or appointed, whether they work in the public eye or more quietly for the public good. The World Bank has found that women tend to invest more of their earnings in their families and communities than men do. That, in turn, makes societies stronger and economies more likely to grow. At the government level, those are the kinds of instincts and priorities we would all like to see. If you're trying to solve a problem, whether it is fighting corruption or strengthening the rule of law or sparking economic growth, you are more likely to succeed if you widen the circle to include a broader range of expertise, experience, and ideas. So as we work to solve our problems, we need more women at the table and in the halls of Parliament and government ministries where these debates are occurring. This is not just about fairness, as important as that is. It is about expanding the pool of talented people to help tackle our biggest problems. Now, women are graduating from universities and graduate programs in ever greater numbers, and in fact, in greater numbers than men in most places. So we would be foolish to ignore that growing resource. And we only need to look at India to see what a dramatic effect it can have. Now, of course, different countries pursue this goal in different ways, but what matters is the result, that more women have the opportunity and the opening to bring their talents to governance and public service. In 2003, a constitutional amendment mandated that one-third of all seats for council leaders in Indian communities should go to women. And over a very short period of time, studies showed that women in these positions started investing more in public services, from clean water to police responsiveness, than their male counterparts had. And there were other benefits. With more women installed as council leaders, more women spoke up in council meetings than ever before. And in a nation where the underreporting of crimes against women is widespread, more women came forward to file complaints about abuse because they were more confident that the police would take action. And in household surveys done in India, conducted among both women and men in these villages, a majority agreed that conditions had improved, that they had to pay fewer bribes to get heard, and that they believed women made capable leaders. And over the course of two election cycles, men cast a growing number of votes for women. Now, that is a huge shift in the political landscape of the world's largest democracy. What happened in India is just one example of what can happen when more women join the ranks of public servants. So we need to create more opportunities in more places. But first, we need to take on the barriers that stand in their way. That means ensuring that governments, schools, and yes, parents work to help young girls grow up believing in their odds of success in any profession, including and perhaps especially the ones traditionally associated with men. By ensuring women have more opportunities to study business, law, economics, science, engineering, and information technology, we can give them both the tools and the confidence to aspire to and serve in government. Now, we also have to acknowledge that even at this point in the 21st century, there are cultural barriers that continue to hold women back, including in too many places, men who think women who belong at home, and also women who think that women belong at home. Imagine my reaction yesterday morning as I was getting ready for my day to hear an interview on our national public radio about a woman running for the Republican nomination, Michelle Bachmann. Now, whether one agrees or disagrees with the position she has taken, she should be judged on her merits. I think we would all agree. And there was an interview with a woman in Iowa who said, you know, I'm still just not comfortable supporting a woman for president. I just don't think a woman could be president. So it's not only in other countries that attitudes need to be addressed. It is even in a country like my own. But as the example in India proved, the best way to turn the tables is to put more women into government and show what a difference it can make, and therefore we need to create more opportunities. I hope that the experiences, the knowledge, the networking that will occur at today's colloquium, the panels and the working groups that will take place, will inform and inspire the initiatives of the Women in Public Service Project, as well as a major educational program that we will be unveiling next summer. We're very excited about this. In June 2012, we will work with the Seven Sisters Colleges to launch an annual summer institute to train emerging women leaders from around the world. A working group of academics and experts are developing a curriculum that will tackle the various issues facing women in public service, and I'm pleased that the founding Sisters Colleges will join together to launch a foundation that will continue to support, coordinate, and sustain these initiatives. And I'm very proud that my alma mater, Wellesley College, will host this inaugural institute, which will rotate to each of the founding sister colleges in the following years. The State Department will support the travel for 40 emerging women leaders from the Middle East and North Africa to go to Wellesley this summer to gain skills in public speaking, coalition building, networking, and mentorship. We hope they will learn more about our democratic systems and the rule of law, that they will have a chance to interact with American students and gain the confidence and inspiration they need to advance in their public service careers at home. I want to say one special word about some of the skills that might be needed. Over this last year of tumultuous change around the world, I have met with women in Egypt, in Libya, in Tunisia, and of course many other places, but let me just focus on those three anchor countries of the Arab awakening. In each place, the women were instrumental in making their voices heard in the effort to move toward a new form of governance, a democratic transition where people's votes would be counted and their voices would matter. But they had no experience in politics, and for many of them, politics was still a kind of dirty word. You know, do you really want to be involved in the electoral process? Do you really want to work on behalf of party politics? Isn't it just enough to get the transition begun? And my point was, you know, if you don't make your own transition from having been part of this extraordinary historic revolution to actually doing the hard and, yes, sometimes boring, difficult work of politics, you may not realize the gains and the hopes that you had demonstrated for. You could end up having one election one time that did not fully empower women or minorities, or people whose values and views were very different from what kind of future you sought would be highly organized and very successful in being elected, and over time you would not be able to participate. So politics is the way in democracy, as maddening as it can be for all of us, where decisions are made, compromises are accomplished. And so I hope that as we think about public service, we also recognize that you are in service to the public, but in a democracy, that means everyone has a stake in who the leaders are and what policies they adopt. Now, all the students who attended the breakfast whom I met earlier, hosted by State Department and USAID alumni from women's colleges, saw how important we believe mentoring and networking are. And we want to build partnerships globally and forge these networks with institutions everywhere, including with Bangladesh's Asian University of Women, which will host a summer institute for women from South Asia, including Afghanistan. Now, empowering and training young women to become public service leaders will be a focus of the State Department's exchange programs. In the audience today are 40 women who have been selected by our embassies around the world to come to the United States for leadership training. They have spent the last 10 days visiting with public servants and civic activists in cities across the United States, as part of our International Visitors Leadership Program, and I'd like to ask these 40 emerging women leaders to stand so that we can recognize them. In the coming months, the State Department will be inviting 20 women college leaders from Mozambique to Mongolia to spend 5 weeks learning about leadership, engaging in community service activities, and interacting with their American peers on two U.S. university campuses. Now, I think we can make a strong case about why more women in politics and government is a good thing, but we need more data to support this. That's why I mentioned the data from India. So we're encouraging scholars and universities around the world to take on this critical research, and we will be offering grants to support rigorous research on women in public service. Securing business sector support for this initiative is crucial, and I am delighted to announce today that Dell has agreed to serve as the technology partner to the Women in Public Service Project. Dell will provide hardware training and other support for the Summer Institutes and the Greater Women in Public Service Project. And Ogilvy Worldwide has assisted in providing public relations and information support. Now, I know there are many more colleges and institutions, corporations, and foundations here today who are eager to join. And we are especially excited that Agnes Scott, Mills, Mount St. Mary's, Scripps, and Spelman Colleges are stepping forward, and we welcome them to this. I hope even more institutions, both public and private, will join with our founding partners to leverage each of your individual strengths and resources to build a truly large, unprecedented global movement to bring more girls and women into public service through leadership, training, mentorship, and networking. Now, we recognize this is just one initiative. We're hoping that more governments, corporations, and universities at all levels and in all regions of the world will also make it a priority to find their own ways to support bringing more women into governance. We think there are lots of ways to make a contribution. Political leaders can do more to recruit women, offer them the mentoring and support that they need. Business leaders can expand efforts to track gender gap inequalities. They can all make that list, like Christine Lagarde said, so they can offer names when there are openings. They can also form public-private partnerships that work internationally to mentor, nurture, and empower young women. And governments and businesses, universities, and other partners can do a lot to open doors. But ultimately, it is up to all of you and millions more like you around the world as to whether you walk through those doors, if you decide to serve, if in fact you dare to compete. I believe doing so offers deep and lasting rewards. I believe you can and will make positive differences in people's lives. That is the essence of public service. It is, for me, really an easy question. Are people better off when you stop than when you started? Have you expanded the circle of opportunity? Have you helped to create conditions where everyone, man and woman, has a chance to live up to his or her God-given potential? Have you brought the world closer together as opposed to either allowing it or pushing it apart? We know what counts for good public service. I see it when I travel, and I see the opposite. I see in too many places where there isn't the leadership or the urgency to make sure that healthcare and education and other services are made available, to reform economies, to fight corruption so that hardworking businessmen and women can realize the benefits of their hard work. So there's a lot to do. It's an exciting journey. And if you decide to take it, you don't just have my blessing. You have my, and more importantly, my country's strong support. We are going to stand behind this initiative now and for years to come. And we, too, hope to see the benefits of what can come when more young women decide that they want to serve their people. Thank you all very much.